So thank you very much. First of all, I would like to thank the organizer for inviting me here. The work I will present today is a joint work with Jonathan Luck from Stanford University. And so let me begin with recalling you what we study in general relativity. So in general relativity, the space-time is described by a manifold M equipped with the Lorentzian metric G. M usually is of dimension 3 plus 1. G is a Lorentzian manifold. Lorentzian metric. And the Einstein equation relates the curvature of the manifold to the distribution of matter and energy present in the universe. And they can be written, so Einstein equation can be written under the form r mu nu minus 1 half of r g mu nu equal t mu nu. R mu nu, it's a Ricci tensor. So it is an object which describes the curvature. R is a trace of Ricci. It is called the scalar curvature. And so G is the metric. And T mu nu is the energy impulsion tensor. So the form of T mu nu depends on the matter model we study. It has a different form if we study, for instance, a fluid or Maxwell an electromagnetic field or a scalar field. So it can have the form depends on what we study. But here we will work in vacuum. So in vacuum, T mu nu is equal to zero. So in vacuum, it's not because it's vacuum that there is only one solution. So of course there is one solution that we all, it's the Minkowski solution. Minkowski solution corresponds to the flat metric G equal minus dt squared plus dx1 squared plus dx2 squared plus dx3 squared. But actually, the set of solution is broader because you can write there is a Cauchy problem for Einstein equation, where from you can there is a notion of initial data, and once you have initial data, you can produce locally a space-time. I will not enter into detail because it's not the subject of today. But instead, I will give you another example of a vacuum solution. So, another example of solution, which is a plane wave solution of Einstein equation. Plane wave solution. So the following metric, G equal B of U squared times E to the E omega U dx squared plus E minus omega U dy squared plus du dv. This metric is an exact solution of Einstein equation provided. So, of Einstein vacuum equation, provided B satisfied the equation B, two derivative of B with respect to U, plus omega squared B equals zero. And for instance, we can choose, so omega must depend on U, but we can choose omega U equal lambda time term alpha U time, for instance, so cosinus U over lambda. So, yeah, this solution is a gravitational wave, if you want, which propagates in the direction U. And the deformation is in a plane which is perpendicular to the direction U. And we can ask, so I had a parameter lambda. Lambda is a wavelength. Vous dites les boutons, pardon. Ça marche. So lambda is a wavelength, and we can ask what happens when lambda tends to zero. Pardon, sorry? So I wrote the metric on this form. It means that if you want to, U would be something like time minus R or... Okay, because it, here it's not du, yeah, du dv, you can, if you write u equal t minus r, v equal t plus r, then you obtain minus dt squared plus dr squared. So it's why it's a wave, so a plane wave, because it depends on t minus, yeah. So what happens when lambda tends to zero? So then omega tends to zero. And B tends to function B zero of U, which satisfied B zero, two derivative of B zero, plus one half of alpha squared, B0 equals 0. And the corresponding metric, G0, it is B0 squared times dx squared plus dy squared plus du dv. So the corresponding metric is no longer a solution of Einstein vacuum equation. Because if you compute, for instance, R UU, it is, in fact, it is not zero because it is equal to, I think, to alpha U squared, I think. Alpha squared, something like that. So you no longer have a solution to Einstein equation. Einstein vacuum equation, but instead you have a solution to Einstein equation with something on the right-hand side, with some scalar field. So this effect, it is what is called the back reaction. So we can ask more generally the following question. Consider a sequence G lambda of solution of Einstein vacuum equation such that G lambda converges strongly toward a metric G0. We can assume that G lambda is regular enough, G0 is also very regular, but we have this kind of convergence in L2 lock, for instance, and such that the derivative of G lambda are bounded in L2 lock. Then We know that d g lambda will converge in the sense of distribution towards the derivative of g0. It converges weakly. But if we have this, this does not mean that the product of derivative of g lambda will converge to a product of derivative of g0. And I forget to remind you what is the form of the Ricci tensor, but Ricci tensor is of the form. You have some terms which are of the form g times 2 derivative of g plus terms which are of the form dg times dg. And so this term in the Ricci, we look at the equation satisfied by g lambda, and we want to pass at the limit when lambda, so the parameter lambda tends to zero. This term will lead to two new terms in the equation. And the question is the following: what will we obtain at the limit? So question. What is the equation satisfied by G0? So what is R mu nu minus 1 half of R G mu nu evaluated in G0? So we can write the limit as in the form T mu nu, but I did nothing by this. I just gave a name, to the limit. And so now I will give you what are the motivations for studying this problem. So the motivation comes from sorry, I'm lost here between the non, celui-là faut que je le descende. Voilà, celui-là faut que le celui-là on va le monter et puis voilà, ce sera très bien. So, motivation. So, this problem was introduced by physicists. It was introduced actually by a physicist called Isaacson in the 60s. And the aim of this physicist was to study some solution of Einstein equation which are high frequency gravitational wave. And by studying this solution, he discovered the principle of back reaction. And then it was also studied by Burnett. I don't remember the day. In the late 80s. And then even later by Green on the world, who this subject again, who studied again this subject. And these physicists, they try to formalize more the problem, a little like I explained to you. And their aim was to study perturbation in cosmology. So in cosmology, so it's a field of general relativity, where you want to study the universe at a large scale, because at large scale, you can assume that, you may assume that the universe is isotropic and homogeneous. And then the equation simplify drastically, and you can have good model to study the evolution of our universe, predict the Big Bang, and things like that. But the thing is, if you look into the universe at small scales, then it's not homogeneous anymore. And the question is, what What is the effect that this small-scale inhomogeneity can produce on the large-scale behavior of the space-time? And what they say is that it's coherent to assume that the perturbations are small at the level of the metric, but it's not coherent anymore to assume that they are small, for instance, at the level of mass. Mass corresponds to two derivatives of the metric. So this should leave the variation of mass should be very big. And so a perturbation theory that they propose is the following, a perturbation which is small in the level of the metric, but only bounded in the level of derivative of the metric. And Burnett made a conjecture. On what should be the possible effect. And his conjecture is that T mu nu actually should have the form of a massless Vlasov matter field. So it is a matter of, an energy impulsion tensor of the form F of T X P. P mu P integrated on the mass shell, which is the P in the tangent space, which are null. P. So it's called massless Vlasov because we only consider null direction, and F should satisfy the transport equation, which corresponds to, which is the usual transport equation satisfied by a density for satisfying a Vlasov model. So yeah, this is only a conjecture, of course, and a question also that he raised is a reverse question. Given a solution of Einstein-Vlasov, can it be approached by a solution of Einstein vacuum equation? By G lambda solution of Einstein vacuum equation. So Green and Wald make the first step toward this conjecture. What they prove is that what the energy impulsor tensor, which is obtained by this process, T must be traceless and satisfy what is called the dominant energy condition. Which says that if you contract T with a two time-like vector, T mu and T nu, it should be positive. T is the time-like vector. So this result actually was quite a disappointment for some physicists because what they hope, secretly or not secretly hope, is that this process, this small-scale inhomogeneity could explain for dark energy. And this dominant energy condition does not allow for dark energy, so it's not so fun anymore. But And what I will present today, so what we constructed with Jonathan Luc is an example to not to prove a Burnett conjecture, but instead it's a first step for this question. So why is it difficult to study this? And for the before our example, all the examples were constructed for assuming some symmetry condition on the equation, which involve two Killing fields, so two symmetries at least. And the example lead at the end to an energy impulsion tensor, which involve two dust propagating in a null direction. So I will explain what are dust later. But the general case is quite difficult because when we study this, so we assume that derivative of G is only bonded, is bonded in L2. So two derivative of G may be very big, and it is known since the work of Scheftel, Roniansky, and Kleinermann that Einstein equation are well posed at the level of the curvature in L2. That means two derivative of G in H2. So here we study solution below the regularity which is needed for Einstein equation to be well posed. So what we have done it's in the middle between two Killing fields and no Killing fields, we study Einstein equation with one Killing field. So Einstein equation, so we consider metric of the form G, so metric G on R3 plus 1 of the form E minus 2 phi G plus E 2 phi dx3 squared, where G is a metric, a Lorentzian metric on R2 plus 1, and phi and G are independent of the coordinate x3. So assuming this symmetry, Einstein vacuum equation are equivalent to a system in 2 plus 1 dimension, which couple a wave equation for phi and the Einstein equation for G. Il n'y a pas de bouton, c'est ça, pour celui-là? D'accord. What we did is we constructed a solution so of Einstein vacuum equation under this symmetry, which converge to the solution of the following system, which is Einstein equation. Alors, let's call it. Dust Einstein equation, which is the following system. So, we have a wave equation for phi. R mu nu is given by d nu phi plus 1/2 the sum of, I will take n dust, so A belongs to set A, where cardinal of A is n, of fa squared d mu ua d nu ua. The ua satisfies the Econal equation, d alpha beta d alpha ua d beta ua equals 0. On the FA, they satisfy the transport equation 2 G alpha beta D beta UA D alpha FA plus the Lambertian of UA times FA equals U. This system is called Einstein dust because dust is a fluid with no pressure. And we have n dust propagating in n null direction. And this can be seen as a particular case of Einstein-Vlasov in the case where the measure here is the sum of n Dirac and n specified null direction. And so our theorem is the following. So let G0, Phi0, FA, UA be a solution of Einstein dust equation on R2 time interval 0, 1, such that the solution should be small, in some sense, regular enough. Phi0, FA, compactly supported. We assume also some condition on the initial data. So t equals 0, surface t equals 0, we assume that it is maximal. That is to say the trace of the second dimensional form is 0, but you can forget this assumption if you want. And also some custom genericity condition. And something which is more important, we assume what we call angular separation of the UA. Yes. Angular separation, which we can write in the form a gradient of UA, scalar gradient of UB over gradient UA, gradient UB. Is less than 1 minus coefficient eta with eta strictly positive. Then there exists a sequence G lambda, phi lambda of Einstein vacuum equation such that G lambda and phi lambda tend strongly in L2 log toward G0, Phi0. And dG lambda and d phi lambda are bounded in L2 log. So in the remaining of the talk, I will give you some ideas about how we prove the result. So the idea would be to start with a guess for phi lambda. The guess would be that phi lambda is like phi zero plus sum over A of FA lambda FA cosinus UA over lambda plus smaller term. And the what we will use very strongly is the fact that when the Ricci tensor in 2 plus 1, we can find a gauge in which its principal symbol is elliptic. So if the if the principal symbol is elliptic, then G will be more regular than phi, and then the coupling term between G and phi could be handled in the equation such that the important part will be this. And this, I will use the calculation later, but a product of derivative of phi tends to d phi zero squared plus exactly what we want. But let me give you what is the elliptic gauge before. So without loss of generality, we can always write the metric G under the form minus n squared dt squared plus gij dxa plus beta a dt dxj plus beta ij dt. And the gauge choice we make is the first one is that so we are in 2D, so a metric in 2D it's always conformal either to the plane or to the sphere or to the hyperbolic plane, but you can make the choice that Gij is of the form E 2 gamma delta ij. So this is the first coordinate choice. It's not a restriction, it's really a coordinate choice. And the second choice is that, so if we consider K as the fundamental form, so K is 1 over 2n, Lie derivative with respect to dt plus dA dxA of gij. So the second choice is that tau, which is the trace of k aj, is equal to zero. So this this gives you three choices, and we are in 2 plus 1 dimension, so it's coherent. And in this gauge, Einstein equation can be written under the form Laplacian, really the Laplacian in R2, of the metric coefficient G. So metric coefficient being n or beta or gamma, equal a quadratic form which depends on G. On d phi plus another quadratic form involving two derivatives of G. So G are metric coefficient n beta gamma. And first result is that Einstein equations are well posed in this gauge. So, theorem. So we consider the three initial data, which are rescaled version of phi. Phi and F. So phi dot is a rescaled version of dt phi, gradient phi, and F, which is a rescaled version of F. So these are the three initial data. We assume that they are compactly supercomported. We assume that they are in HK with K bigger than 3. But more importantly, we assume some smallness. But we had to assume some smallness to do the local well-posedness. But we don't want to assume too much smallness. Otherwise, it will not allow for the high-frequency perturbation we consider. So the smallness we assume is only on L infinity norm of this guy. Is less than epsilon. And also, we assume some conditions which are necessary to work in what is called maximal gauge, so with tau equal to zero. And this condition is that phi dot dg phi plus one half of f chetch gradient u dg u. Sorry, there is another free initial data, which is a U. But on this, we don't have to assume so much thing. So we assume also this integral condition, which is to work with tau equals zero. So then, Einstein dust equation is a locally well posed in elliptic gauge. So this is for the local well posedness. It's not actually not so straightforward because of the fact that we can only assume smallness at this level, but not at the level of at a higher regularity level. The time of existence depends on the size of this guy on the H3 norm, but it's okay for the what we do because what we have to is just to start to be able to start, and then. We will be able in the proof of this result to go further because of the special form we assume on our data. So the second part of the proof is to construct parametrics. So we will look for phi under the form phi equal phi zero plus sum of lambda fa cosinus ua over lambda plus the remainder, which is a big O of lambda squared. And when I write this, I mean that if I take a derivative, then I lose the power of lambda. And now, so for simplification, we can assume that phi zero equals zero in this talk. And then if we calculate the product of d phi e phi squared, it will be sum of fa, fb, dua, dub, sinus of ua over lambda, sinus of ub over lambda, plus a big O of lambda. When a derivative falls on f, then we keep the power of lambda in front. So these terms give a big O of lambda. So a thing like that, it's only a bigot of one, but we can decompose it like this. So we have the, we keep the term which where A is B, is equal to B. Then it gives you FA squared dUA squared time sinu squared of UA over lambda. Sinu squared will be 1/2 plus cosinus of 2UA over lambda plus the sum for A difference on B of FA FB dUA dUB time cosinus of UA plus or minus UB over lambda. So this first term is what we expected to have. We can call it Laplacian of G0. Because G0, we expect on the right-hand side to have a term which is a sum of FA squared d mu A, d nu A. So it's here. This term, it's actually similar to this, so let's look at this one. This one is only a big O of 1, but we will call it Laplacian of G1. But actually, if we this give G1 is not a big O of 1, because we can write explicitly what is G1. G1 is a sum of FAB lambda squared dUA dUB over gradient of UA plus or minus UB squared time cosinus of UA plus or minus UB over lambda. So G1 is actually big O of lambda squared. So G behaves better than phi in terms of power of lambda. And here I divided by this, which might be zero, but it's why we had to assume the angular separability to be able to divide by this. And the remainder here, we call it box G2. Box G2 is big O of lambda, which means that G2 in H2 is less than lambda. So the derivative of G2 is like lambda. Let's look at the equation for phi now. Can calculate the Lambertian G of FA lambda FA cos UA over lambda. This is equal to 1 over lambda G alpha beta D alpha UA D beta UA time cosinus plus G 2 d alpha beta d alpha ua d beta fa plus bog g ua fa time sinus plus a big O of lambda. And so fortunately, we choose so we assume some equation on FA and UA, which are made to cancel the worst term on the equation. There is no term in 1 over lambda, because if here it's G0, then this term cancels. And here also, if it's G0, this term cancels because of the equation we assume on F. But with what we did, if we look at the second term, for instance, G minus G0, G alpha beta minus G, this is only a big O of lambda. So we have lambda over lambda. It's only a big O of 1, which is not sufficient. So we will have to construct a, we need a more precise parametrics. And this more precise parametrics will consist in describing what are the next order term in phi. The next order term in phi would be phi equal, so what we have, the sum of fa ra, plus the next order term would be of the form lambda squared f tilde sinus of ua over lambda. And we don't see again the same problem because here, when we we consider a term which is a cross product between a derivative of this and a derivative of this, we obtain a term, so cross product, R of the form FA F tilde cosinus. Sinus of ua over lambda times cosinus of ua over lambda. And these terms are high frequency. This is the sinus of 2 ua over lambda. I'm sorry, the lambda. And this can be dealt with as the G1 term. So there is some orthogonality that allow us to go further. And there is a point which is very important. Actually, this procedure will not work for a model problem of the form only, so not work for a model problem of the form of this form. Because there are terms which we cannot control very well, is the time derivative of G. Because no control on time derivative of G. Because to have control the derivative of G, then we have to derive with respect to T the elliptic equation. And then it's not DTG is not as good as the space derivative of G. And so it is very important to rely on the structure of Einstein equation. Which says that so the condition tau equals zero actually gives you that the derivative with respect to time of the metric coefficient gamma is like a derivative with respect to space of the metric coefficient beta. And the other coefficient, n, dtn and dt beta, they miraculously cancel in the equation for phi. Because the derivative with respect to t of g, they appear on, for instance, here. This involves a derivative with respect to time of G. So they cancel. And this is really the key to prove three, the theorem. And let me conclude with some perspectives. Perspectives would be so Here we find an example with an energy impulsion tensor which consists in n dust. What happens if we let n tend to infinity? What we would expect is to have to have a continuous Vlasov model, but does not seem so easy because if we let n tend to infinity, we will not have any more angular separation, so there is something to do. Another perspective also is to try to construct an example without the symmetry. This seems quite hard. And of course, another perspective is to prove a Burnett conjecture, which is the reverse problem. It would be a really different approach. And thank you very much for your attention.